Despite the findings of most in vitro studies, most of the more popular botanical supplements appear not to pose a serious risk for herb-drug interactions. And that's probably due to several reasons. One is just many of these phytochemicals have very poor oral bioavailability to begin with. And a lot of times that's a function of the dosage form. And it's also a function of the, it's also due to the fact that a lot of these phytochemicals undergo extensive pre-systemic metabolism in the gut and in the liver. And so they may never reach the systemic circulation and concentrations to be all that important. So again, we've got a few of the more popular botanicals here that don't appear to pose a significant herb-drug interaction risk because of those issues of dosage form performance and extensive metabolism. All right, so now, this whole issue of dosage form performance, as a pharmacist, it's a big deal to us. But oftentimes, we're the only ones that have an appreciation for whether or not something as prosaic as will the tablet or capsule disintegrate, and will the components in that go into solution? Most folks, we're all spoiled because with conventional drug products, the FDA says they have to disintegrate and they have to have good dissolution profiles before so they can be effective. That's not the case with dietary supplements. So when we're talking about dosage form performance, I'm talking about just situations where the product disintegrates and goes into solution. And whether or not the compounds, these phytochemicals, go into solution, oftentimes is a function of their physical chemical properties, whether they're what their molecular weight is, whether they have decent aqueous solubility, or whether they're very lipophilic, and what their permeability coefficients may be. So there's a wide variety of things that can affect whether or not a product goes into solution. And so I think that oftentimes we're missing the boat with herb-drug interactions, or even the efficacy of botanicals, simply because of these. The simple thing is dissolution and disintegration. And the reason you don't see that is that most of the current good manufacturing practices for botanical dietary supplements just don't require that products undergo dissolution or disintegration testing. Moreover, the United States Pharmacopeia, their dissolution standards, they've only been established for, I think it's 4 or 5 botanical monographs, you know, so the vast majority of botanicals out there, we really know very little about their dissolution profiles, all right? And again, I'm not going to get into a lot of gory details, but there are ways you can assess disintegration and dissolution using a dissolution apparatus. I just threw this up here from another talk I was giving, but the bottom line is that the dissolution profiles for most dietary supplements is just unknown, all right? So what I want to do is kind of illustrate how I think that's important in terms of both looking at two botanicals, Goldenseal and Kava. Now, both Goldenseal and Kava have these methylene dioxyphenyl, have phytochemicals that contain these methylene dioxyphenyl groups. We talked about hydrastine and berberine in Goldenseal. In Kava, there's methistacin and dihydromethistacin. And if you look at the literature, in vitro, all four of these compounds can inhibit a wide variety of cytochrome P450 enzymes. Right? So you would think, well, then they all should, you know, both of these should cause some significant herb-drug interactions. Well, Goldenseal certainly does, but Kava doesn't, at least with the dosage formulations we were using in this study, there was really no difference in the effects of Kava on midazolam. And midazolam is a benzodiazepine that is a classic substrate for 3A4. So if you can affect midazolam kinetics, you're primarily affecting 3A4 activity. So you can see here that Kava really doesn't have much of an effect. But Goldenseal has a significant, not only statistically, but also clinically significant increase in the area under the curve for midazolam. So what's the deal? Why don't both of those correlate to a significant clinically relevant herb-drug interaction? And the same thing holds true with CYP2D6. Here again, different study. Goldenseal inhibits 2D6 activity, Kava, no effect whatsoever. Why is that? You know, and well, does dissolution play a role? Right? And so what I want to show you here are the dissolution profiles for those phytochemicals in some different dosage forms. So this is a classic Goldenseal extract, and you can see that the dissolution rate is perfect for berberine and hydrastine. They're released very quickly, and they're released almost completely. Whereas with at least this particular Kava product here, hardly released at all. All right. So, and if, and it, one of the basic tenets of pharmaceutics is if the drug can't go into solution, it can't be absorbed. Right? And so here's another formulation, a different formulation. This is adding lecithin to the Kava formulation, and that certainly helps the release profile. But again, it's pretty slow, and it's not all that complete. So it's quite possible that the fact that many of these phytochemicals just never get into solution is one of the reasons why, one, they may not be effective, and two, they may not be causing a lot of interactions. And so I think that's the case for most of these products here.